And he's riding his horse or his mule. And the name of that mule is Shahba. فلما خشى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم نزل عن بغلته. When they came close, they went. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم has landed off the mule. يعني he got off صلى الله عليه وسلم. ثم قبض قبضة من تراب. فلما خشى. When they came close, meaning the enemy, because they're in a war zone now, right? They're right, you know, war zone. The kuffar has come close to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and the Muslim army. فلما خشى. Means when they attacked us. فنزل رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم عن بغلته. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم went off with his mule, which is called الشهباء. ثم قبض قبضة من تراب. And he took a handful of dust or تراب, whatever it is, dirt. قبضة من تراب. ثم استقبل به وجههم, وجوههم. And then he turned and he threw that dirt into their faces. فقال شاهد الوجوه. May their faces be blinded. فما خلق الله منهم إنسانا إلا ملا عينيه ترابا بتلك القبضة. So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم had taken a handful of dust and he threw it or dirt and he threw it in the faces of the kuffar. The Sahabi is saying, I swear by Allah, each one of them was rubbing his eyes, and there were about 1,000. Each one of them was rubbing his eyes from the dirt that got into their eyes. Said the one, وَمَا رَمَيْتَ إِذْ رَمَيْتَ. This is the ayah. وَمَا رَمَيْتَ إِذْ رَمَيْتَ وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ رَمَى. So whatever you come across about the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, any miracles that you hear about the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, don't think it's too much. Don't think it's too much. Because Allah has no limit. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is great. And Allah is capable of doing anything. So by the will of Allah, the creator of the air, Allah has ordered the wind to carry the particles of dust to enter the eyes of the kuffar, to blind them. فَوَلُّوا مُدْبِرِينَ. And then they ran away. So obviously the Muslims have won. So if it wasn't for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then why did the Sahaba need to fight? If the Prophet he can do this easily, blindfold the kuffar, you know? So what did the Sahaba need to fight for? For what reason then? To teach them that the deen of Allah requires sacrifice. أَلَا إِنَّ سِلْعَةُ اللَّهِ غَالِيَةٌ. Sil'ah is the property of Allah. Is expensive. أَلَا إِنَّ سِلْعَةُ اللَّهِ هِيَ الْجَنَّةِ. That the property of Allah is Jannah. And it is expensive. It means you need to sacrifice to get Jannah. If Jannah is expensive, right? And Jannah is not as important to a Muslim life as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If you had the choice between entering Jannah or seeing the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, seriously, ask yourself this question: which one would you choose? I know what I would choose, but which one would you choose? Entering Jannah or seeing the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, yani being with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Think about it, and we'll go back to it, inshallah. So the kuffar were moving, then they ran away through a single act of Prophet. So the one that made Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala throw the dust or throw the turab, he ordered the wind to carry the particles and enter the eyes of the kuffar or the disbelievers. It is the same Allah that gave all the previous characteristics and miracles of Prophet. And this has been by Al-Kharajah Muslim. And we'll conclude inshallah azza wa jal in a few minutes about the chest of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Qala Hind ibn Abi Hala, and Hind is the son of Sayyidah Khadija from the previous husband of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Okay? He was the son of Sayyidah Khadija, who was the wife of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to another man before the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because she was married before him. And he's the uncle of Sayyidina Hassan Hussein. And he used to have the best way to describe the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. No one could describe the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam like he used to. He said, كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم سواء البطن والصدر. That his stomach and chest were flat. Right? So the sunnah is to have a flat chest and stomach. عريض الصدر and a wide chest, صلى الله عليه وسلم. رواه الطبراني والترمذي في الشمالين. قالت عائشة رضي الله عنها, كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم عريض الصدر ممسوحة. His chest was wide and flat. كأنما المراية في شدتها واستوائها. When you look at the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم's chest and stomach, as if it is a flattened mirror. And this is someone who married the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, meaning she lived with him صلى الله عليه وسلم, meaning she saw his exact description. She saw every part of his body صلى الله عليه وسلم. Right? كأنه المراية في شدتها واستوائها. It was so clear and so flat like a mirror. It means it has no wavy in between. يعني not like me, extensive, mashallah, كرش, and a floppy upper body. لا يعد بعض لحمه بعضا. That he did not have overlapping of meat, صلى الله عليه وسلم. He did not have overlaps of meat around him, صلى الله عليه وسلم. على بياض القمر ليلة البدر. So his body, صلى الله عليه وسلم, was as pure and white as that of the moon, صلى الله عليه وسلم. موصول ما بين لبته إلى صرته الشعر. Between his belly button, صلى الله عليه وسلم. And just below the chest, right here. A fine line of very fine hairs. منقاد قلقدين. As if it is a line of a branch. Very fine, as if it's a line of branch. لم يكن في صدره ولا بطنه شعر. His upper chest and his stomach had no hairs. Except a line running down from the bottom of his chest, صلى الله عليه وسلم, to his navel. رواه ابن عيم وابن عساكر والبيهقي. This has been narrated by ابن عيم وابن عساكر والبيهقي. So the Prophet, صلى الله عليه وسلم, has had a clear chest, صلى الله عليه وسلم, as bright as the moon, as flat as the mirror. And the Prophet, صلى الله عليه وسلم, as we go on, inshallah, we'll talk later on, is that he even had the six-pack, what we call nowadays, صلى الله عليه وسلم. They were so distinct. And the Sahaba used to say, when we used to look at him, we used to think he's a statue of one of those Roman statues, صلى الله عليه وسلم. You know how they make, the masons, they make very perfect figures of those statues of their predecessors, of their kings, whatever? We need to look at him as if he was a statue, a perfect figure of a statue, صلى الله عليه وسلم. Yani you design it the way you want to design. Of course it's gonna be. He's the beloved of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, great of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I missed one thing about his neck, صلى الله عليه وسلم. كأنه جيد دمية. One of the Sahaba said, كأنه جيد دمية. His neck was so beautiful, صلى الله عليه وسلم, as if his neck is neck of the gazelle, al-ghazal, or a deer, what we call nowadays. And this, in the Arabic terms, when you say someone, mashallah, her neck is as if it's a ghazal, right? It's a sign of beautification. It's a sign of beauty. Walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Allahumma salli ala sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa ashabihi wa awlaadihi wa azwaaji wa dhurriyatihi wa abaydihi tayyibna tayyib rahmatika ya arhamar rahimin. Allahumma fahimna ma'alamtana. Allahumma fahimna ma'alamtana. Allahumma fahimna ma'alamtana. Allahumma sallika ya arhamar rahimin. Ya arhamar rahimin. كما أكرمت علينا ومننت علينا في هذا الوقت المبارك جمعتنا في بيت من بيوتك لكي نستأثر بأثر حبيبك المصطفى صلى الله عليه وسلم أن تجعلنا تحت لواءه يوم العرض عليك بمنك وجودك وكرمك يا أكرم الأكرمين وكل على نيته الفاتحة. الذكر والتذكير والنفع والانتفاع والإفادة والاستفادة والحث على التمسك بكتاب الله وسنة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وصحبه والاه والدعاء إلى الهدى والدلالة على الخير ابتغاء وجه الله ومرضاته سبحانه جل وعلا وقربه وثوابه سبحانه وتعالى ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا. We praise Allah سبحانه جل وعلا and we thank Him and we admit that we have shortened fall of His taking سبحانه جل وعلا. And we say in pleasant about Prophet صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم that Allah سبحانه جل وعلا for the past few weeks have gathered us together to unite us together around the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa sallam. And the whole idea of our lessons and our lectures, and I don't like to call them lessons or lectures, they're more like discussions. So this gives, inshallah, each individual input. Sometime throughout the lesson or the talk or discussion, I will ask a question and I'll also request your input, inshallah, azawajal. So we try to treat each other, inshallah, not so much between a master and the students, but we're all brothers of Islam, inshallah, azawajal. And we are here to adhere together, to bond together, like a strong wall as the Prophet has claimed for us. For the past few weeks, we have been concentrating on the description of Sayyidina Muhammad. And I keep using the same example. If we are unable to identify how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alaihi wasallam looked like in this world, if you don't know how he looked like in this world, for a surety you're not going to know how he's going to look like in hereafter. You're not going to recognize him sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So this is the idea. What do you know about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? So we got on, inshallah azza wa jal, who would like to remind us what was the last part of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Now you had to go last to Muhammad, so we'll go to Ahmed. The chest of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So we go back, inshallah, one step backwards. قال هند بن ابن هلال رضي الله عنه كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وصحبه وسلم سواء البطن والصدر. هند بن هلال, he is the uncle of Sayyidina Hussein. He was the son of Sayyidina Khadija, the wife of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. And he was good, he had a very good skill at describing the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. So amongst his description, and he got to the stomach of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said that he had a flat stomach صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم. عريض الصدر, that his chest was wide صلى الله عليه وسلم. And this been narrated by Tabrani and Tirmidhi. فقالت عائشة رضي الله عنها كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم عريض الصدر ممسوحة, which is flattened, wide chest and flattened stomach. كأنه المراية في شدتها واستوائها, as if it is a mirror, which is as flat as a mirror. لا يعد بعد لحمه بعضا, which means he never had overlapping flaps of meat. Or if you want to be frank, flaps of fat. على بياض القمر ليلة البدر, he was so beautiful, the chest of Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, so white, as clear and as bright as the full moon when it's zenith, when it's full moon, صلى الله عليه وسلم. موصول ما بين ربته إلى سرته شعر من قاد كالقديم. Between his chest صلى الله عليه وسلم to his belly button, a line of perfectly straightened hair, line of hair. Very light, very small hairs. From his chest to his belly button. لم يكن في صدره ولا في بطنه شعر. So he had no hair on his chest صلى الله عليه وسلم and no hair around his stomach except for that line صلى الله عليه وسلم. And you're probably wondering, subhanAllah, I thought it's awra to look at the man's body. The awra is only between the navel and the knees, just to let you know, inshallah. And this has been narrated by Abu Na'im ibn Asakir. So what about the fate of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, or the legs of Sayyidina Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم? عن أبي جحيفة رضي الله عنه قال وخرج رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم كأني أنظر إلى بياض ساقيه كأني أنظر إلى بياض ساقيه. So he's given description that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم had walked or had passed as if I'm able to see the whiteness of his legs, the whiteness of his legs. And if we look from the time we describe the face of Sayyidina Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم to his teeth, to his chest, to his hands, to his face, to his feet, they all circle around the same description, which is bright, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he has to be bright. Within him is the word of Allah. He was Quranan yatanaqqalu bayna an-nas, or Quranan yamshi al-ard, as Sayyidina Aisha has narrated. This is Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So when you talk about the Quran, and the Quran is kalam Allah, right? So how do you not expect a man like the Prophet ﷺ, within him is contained the word of Allah, the Quran, and not the glints like the sun, or even more brighter. So nothing is amazing about that. So about about his fate, قال هند بن أبي هالة رضي الله عنه كان النبي صلى الله عليه وآله وصحبه وسلم خمصان الأخمصين الأخمص من القدم ما بين صدرها وعقابها. Which means when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was walking, he had an arched heel, an arched inside of the leg, which means the heel of the foot, the heel of the foot, and the toes of the foot were the only ones touching the ground, together with the left side of the foot or the right side of the foot. But the arch was always raised above, so he did not have flat feet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's what he's referring to. He did not have flat feet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. وهو الذي لا يلتصق بالأرض من القدمين يريد أن ذلك منه مرتفع مسيح القدمين. His feet صلى الله عليه وسلم were smooth and silky. Whenever water would run over them. Similar to an example when you wax your car. Right? When you wax your car and droplets of water go on it, what happens to the water? It disperses. Such was the feet of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. And they're so smooth and so silky. وشسنا الكفين والقدمين, which means the well, nice and smooth. And his hands, sorry, his fingers, صلى الله عليه وسلم, whether it's his toes or his fingers, صلى الله عليه وسلم, they were nice tapered and large. وكان صلى الله عليه وسلم أشبه الناس بسيدنا إبراهيم عليه السلام. So he looked like, mostly like سيدنا إبراهيم. So if you, someone asked you, how did سيدنا إبراهيم عليه السلام look like? He looked like سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. And سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم looked like سيدنا إبراهيم عليه السلام. And he used to say, وأشبه الناس بإبراهيم صاحبكم. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد. Referring to himself. وأشبه الناس بإبراهيم صاحبكم. Referring to himself صلى الله عليه وسلم. Toyota RAV4 is blocking the driveway. If someone can move it, please, the brother. Good luck, then. And the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم had said, ورأيت إبراهيم والأشبه أشبه الناس بولده صلى الله عليه وسلم. And I'm the most who looks like إبراهيم عليه السلام. ما رأيت شبها كشبه قدر النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بقدر إبراهيم التي كنا نجدها في المقام. So this is a Sahabi, وكان أبو جهم ابن حذيفة القريشي. He used to say, I have never seen a footprint, the same one that we see in Mecca, which is in the close to the Maqam, Maqam Sayyidina Ibrahim. Those brothers who went to Mecca, this footprint of Sayyidina Ibrahim عليه السلام. So this Sahabi is saying, I have never seen a more perfect and more similar looking feet to that of Sayyidina Ibrahim عليه السلام than to that of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. And this is another confirmation of the Prophet of Sayyidina Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, that he is a descendant of Sayyidina Ibrahim عليه السلام. Some people might think, hang on, you know, there is no DNA these days. True, but the Arabs at that time had a skill. It's called ilm al-farasa at that time. They knew, if they looked at you, they knew exactly which tribe you belong to, right? There's some of the problems you've come across in dunya, in life, you know, features on your face, what you represent, from which noble family you could come from, you could have come from, and they were very good at that. This is the skills the Arabs had. This part that they were called, Yam al-Jahiliyah, they had the side of ignorance.